Join in the webinar, a conceptual overview. Just a minute. I welcome you all for the webinar on a conceptual overview on reserve estimation techniques. So let us start our webinar. So we will, today we are going to discuss about what exactly are petroleum reserves, and what are the type of petroleum reserves, and how do you categorize, and what is its status globally, and how do you estimate it, and what are the proven techniques for reserve estimations. So what exactly are petroleum reserves? Like, always, like, there is a difference between reserves and resources. So the place where petroleum gets accumulated, probably hydrocarbons gets accumulated in a particular location, that can be named as petroleum reserve. Like reservoir can be named it as a petroleum reserve. Physical availability of these hydrocarbons, if it can be estimated with respect to barrels, that can be known to be petroleum reserves. So let us see on what categories petroleum reserves can be estimated. Like hydrocarbon deposits predominantly occurring in subsurface geological formations. So we do have different formations like reservoir, as well as cap rock, as well as source rock. So in reservoir, we'll be having this kind of deposits, hydrocarbon deposits, which were physically present and which can be estimated by geological, geophysical, and geochemical, any kind of exploration methods which can be applied, and we can able to estimate that there is some amount of physical presence of crude oil is occurring there, that can be named it as petroleum reserves. And reserves can be taken like even after developing the field, that also can be taken as a reserve. So reserves are either discovered or likely to be discovered in future. Sometimes technology is not enough at present to discover crude oil. Probably we need some advanced technology to research where exactly crude oil have been deposited. That also can be considered as reserves. So technological expertise, either current or in the future, must be in place to exploit the deposits of petroleum. So all the time technology could not be enough to extract or else to estimate the amount of crude oil which have been deposited in the subsurface. So that could be a constraint. So that also, the reason is since technology is not there, so you couldn't able to extract reserves, that doesn't matter. But actually reserves were present over there, but technology is becoming a major constraint. And then another constraint is economic feasibility. Probably recession could affect industry in such a way that we cannot able to invest for the projects to exploit crude oil from some locations. Probably reserves might be there over there. But unfortunately, because of economic feasibility, there could be lack of projects for certain locations, even though reserves were present. So that also could be taken as an economic constraint. Reserves can be reported in the context of reservoir, field, petroleum basin, or country as a whole. So when we name that as a reserve, that can be contexted with either a reservoir or a field or a petroleum basin, or else as a country as a whole, like that, we can able to context reserve to be like that. Then what is resources? So reserves are those which, where we can able to categorize that as a physical presence of crude oil in one particular location that can be considered as a reserve. But what is resource? Resource are those kind of locations where it will accommodate crude oil. Like probably a resource might not be present over there, but there is a chance that in coming days, probably reserves could accumulate over there inside the resource. So reservoir like sandstone as well as limestone, these can be considered as resources for crude oil accumulation. If not today, maybe tomorrow. Probably shale would be there near to that reservoir, so that if not today, maybe one day, you can able to extract, or else you can able to observe that there is an accumulation of crude oil in that particular reservoir. So reserves have been subdivided into three categories. One is proved reserves, probable, and possible reserves. So proved reserves are those reserves which have been already developed. So already production is in progress. So that kind of reserves can be considered as proved reserves. sometimes there are like chances of producing crude oil near to the developed fields. Some places will be there where there is good chance of producing crude oil by the estimation of your earlier data, like data history or like geological, geophysical, or else nearby, there are some produced fields are there which can able to encourage in that particular area, probably there could be a chance of producing good amount of crude oil. So that also can be considered as crude. Crude reserves will be having 90% certainty of commercial extraction. So based on the data, based on the progress at that current status, we can able to estimate, we can able to identify crude reserves that there is 90% chances are there for that production of that kind of reserves, or reserves which were located as proved reserves. And 10% challenge is there for proved reserves. When it comes to probable reserves, probably they were not developed. They are planning to get developed. So they are underdeveloped. They could be in underdeveloped process. So like you have to, it was not yet completely proven. So there are like some gaps and uncertainties are there in exploration and other areas, so that 50% chances are there that these probable reserves could give you commercial exploitation. But when it comes to other 50%, still there is some data has to be extracted. There is no, we cannot able to go with 90% confidence like proved reserves, but probably 50% confidence level is there. Why? Because probably because of the lack of data, or else there could be a lack of technology, economic feasibility to collect the data, or any kind of reason it could be. But the data what we have at currently, it is progressing us that we can able to extract about 50%. Like 50% extraction could be possible. Other 50% challenges were there which has to be explored. Then next comes possible reserves. This is like 90% challenges are there. Only minimum data is there that is encouraging that 10% chances of producing reserves. Yes, reserves were physically present, but the chances of producing was very much less. That could be around 10%. Remaining 90% confidence, we need to get it from the data which is going to be generated. So still research has to be done so that you can able to extract a good amount of data, so that that will give you even more confidence for that kind of reserves, that is possible reserves. So how do you categorize it? How do you categorize these reserves? We have like four categories, like category A, B, C1 and C2, D1, D2 and D3. So category A reserves are actually developed reserves. These were already been developed. They started to get produced. So you started extracting crude oil from the reservoir that can be coming under category A. So even there are certain category A reserves are there where the data is showing you confidence in such a way that it can able to extract good amount of reserves. Probably 90% confidence is there. That is for category A reserves. When it comes to category B reserves, those reserves which were matured, which comes under the drainage of already developed fields. So developed field are those fields where it started to extract good amount of oil. But when it comes to category B, those reserves which were in the domain of the drainage area of category A reserves, that can be considered as category B. So these reserves are also proven reserves with the data what you have collected earlier with the history data, like geological, geophysical or seismics, any kind of data, whatever it has been done earlier. So that is showing you that the chances of producing these reserves are positive. But the thing is, it was not developed. So they are underdeveloped category reserves. So these reserves can be considered as category B. When it comes to category C1 and C2, these reserves are adjacent to the drainage distance. So drainage area is that area where your crude oil have been drained enough, there the pressure difference have been generated so that fluid flow started to start in that particular area. That is what we will be naming that as drainage area. But beyond the drainage area, crude oil will be stable. So that kind of reserves will come under C1 and C2 category, where it was not even, there is no flow mechanism, nothing was like done, any kind of dynamic activities over there. Only the thing is crude oil was present over there beyond the drainage area of the category A reserves, that can be considered as C1 and C2 category reserves. So when it comes to D1, D2, D3, these are the reserves which these are not actually to say these are not reserves. These are like resources. Why? Because reserves are those which were observed under reservoir. But these D1, D2, D3 categories, we cannot say that as reserves. These are resources. Probably this could be some kind of lithofacies which are near to the reservoirs where it is producing good amount of crude oil. So might be there might be a chance of producing oil in that kind of lithofacies. Why? Because probably some historical data is giving us confidence in such a way that these lithological faces also can produce crude oil. It is not just reservoir will be producing crude oil. Even shale acts as a reservoir. Even sometimes shale acts as a trap as well as a reservoir. So there are certain historical data will be there which will support that some lithofacies which were present near to the reservoir, which was completely producing, whichever comes under category A, that could also encourage us to produce. Probably there could be some kind of technology which can be implemented over there so that you can able to extract good amount of oil from such reserves. Those reserves which are not reservoirs, those come under category D reserves. So let us see how these reserves can be observed in a field level. So if you could observe in this this image, two wells have been drilled, and you can see these areas which were considered to be drainage areas. So you can see this is a drainage area. This is a drainage area, and wells have been drilled. They started to get extracted. These particular kind of reserves we can name that as category A. When it comes to category B, probably the wells which were drilled on the drainage area. Imagine this is the domain of these drainage areas. On this particular domain, if you start drilling a well, that can come under category B. So when it comes to category C, it is the distance of the drainage area, like near to the end of the drainage boundary. So here there is no dynamic activity. There is no movement at all. So flow have been ceased. Only the flow happens inside the drainage area. But there could be a chance of producing oil beyond the drainage area. So those kind of reserves can be categorized as C1 reserves. So C2, which were like away from the drainage area, which might be in between two drainage areas. Like some resources will be there, which are in between drainage areas. So these particular reserves can also be considered as C2 category reserves. So C1, C2, and when it comes to D2, actually, if you could observe in this image, you can see oil, gas, which can be compressed as a reservoir. You can see the flow of oil. So this is water, this is oil, this is gas. So this is actually a reservoir. So there is a fault which have been observed over here. So gas was observed, permeable limestone as well as impermeable limestone. So you can see this is a reservoir. But above this, there are a number of lithofacies have been placed. So if you could able to drill, like probably shale is there, which acts as a cap rock of this reservoir, there could be a chance of producing oil from shale. Why? Because shale, either as a cap rock or else as a source rock, it has some potential of producing crude oil. As a source rock, it has good potential, but when it comes to cap rock, probably since there is a lack of oil, demand might be more. So we could able to use some kind of technology so that there could be a chance of producing these crude oil at some lithofacies where there is an history that it has produced earlier. Like crude oil have been produced from these lithofacies earlier. So based on that history, we are planning to drill on such lithofacies for getting a chance of producing crude oil. So these category reserves will be considered as D category reserves. So if you could observe status of these category reserves, it has been these kind of category reserves have been placed in USA, India, like A, B, C1. We can see crude reserves in USA. When it comes to India, A and B. When it comes to Iran, A, B, Malaysia. So there are like different category reserves have been placed at different countries, which have been given this data over here. So probable reserves like C1, C2, that also is available in different countries. D1, as well as speculative reserves like D2 and D1 for different countries, it has been observed over here. So let us come to how do you estimate these reserves? There are like four different methods are there to estimate. One is volumetric, material balance, production decline curve, and simulation. So there are like these four proven techniques are there to estimate reserves. So first one is volumetric. Before getting into volumetric estimations, these volumetric estimation methods is applicable when the reservoir is homogeneous. When it comes to heterogeneous, when number of phases were observed, the number of fluids have started to encroach into reservoir, volumetric might not be a good option to implement, to estimate reserves. So how we can able to estimate reserves by applying this method, that is volumetric. So for oil, the formula to estimate a crude, that is like amount of oil can be estimated, that is like N, can be given as area of the reservoir, that is A, and H will give you the thickness of the reservoir, and phi will give you the porosity of the reservoir, and 1 minus SWI is the saturation of oil. Actually, SO is equal to 1 minus SWI. 1 SWI represents initial saturation of water by BOI. BOI represents formation volume factor of oil. It is the volume, it is the ratio of volume between reservoir volume to the stock tank of oil. So you are going to measure volume of oil at reservoir to the same volume when you bring it to surface, what will happen to that volume. So that ratio we can be considered as formation volume factor, and that is BOI. So this term 7758, which was given to estimate N with respect to barrels. Why? Because if area was given in acres, when you cross multiply acres with 7758, then it can be converted to barrel. So amount of oil can be given in this form, AH5 into 1 minus SWA, or else if you have the saturation of oil, AH5 into SO by BOI. So always we have to subdivide BOI. If you are removing this BOI, the same formula can be applied without BOI also. If you are not including BOI means, it is going to give you the volume of oil irrespective of reservoir. If you want to consider reservoir volume, then you need to include the term that is BOI. In the same way, when you are talking about gas, so the amount of gas which was present inside reservoir in situ. So in situ amount of gas which was present inside reservoir can be given in the same formula, like area of the reservoir into H, that is thickness of the reservoir, into phi, that is porosity of the reservoir, into 1 minus SWI. So probably if the reservoir is having only gas, then 1 minus SWI will be giving you SG. If the reservoir is having oil, then 1 minus SWI will be giving you SO. If they are considering like oil, gas, and water, then SO plus SG plus SWI will complete the reservoir. So 1 minus SWI will be giving you SO plus SG. So it all depends on, if your reservoir is completely filled with gas, then 1 minus SWI will be giving you only SG. So area into H into phi. So area was given in acres. So if you want to convert into gas units, that gas units will be cubic feet. So if you want to convert acres to cubic feet, then you need to add 43,560. And BGI represents formation volume factor of gas at initial conditions. So in the same way, the gas will be measured at reservoir. The same amount of gas which you have measured at reservoir will be taken to surface conditions. Then that amount will be subdivided by your original volume of gas which was present inside reservoir. That will be named as formation volume factor of gas. And suffix I is there, that represents initial conditions. So this is how we can able to estimate amount of oil at reservoir at the same time amount of gas at reservoir. So after this, if you could go for material balance equation, this equation was for it is the combination drive mechanism equation. Like we are having different types of drive mechanisms. There could be like water drive will be there, depletion drive will be there, gas drive will be there, and gravity acts as a drive mechanism. So all together, even the rock compaction, compressibility of rock, compressibility of fluid also acts as a drive mechanism. If you could include all these energy drive mechanisms in your estimation, then you can able to get material balance equation like this. So N represents the amount of oil at reservoir, that is equal to NP, the amount of oil which have been produced, into PO, that is formation volume factor of oil, into GP, amount of gas produced. So P represents, the suffix P represents produced. When there is no suffix P, when there is a suffix of I, that represents initial conditions. So NP represents amount of oil which have been produced. N represents amount of oil which was present inside the reservoir. So NP was the amount of oil which have been lost from the reservoir. You have to, after some time, the amount of oil started to produce from the well and it will be collected at the surface. So that means some amount have been lost inside the reservoir. So that amount is NP. So when it comes to RS, that is solution gas. So the gas which have been dissolved in unit amount of oil, probably some cubic feet of gas might have dissolved in one barrel of oil. So that can be considered as RS. When it comes to BG, formation volume factor of gas. When it comes to WE, this is the amount of water which have been encroached from the nearby water pool. So always a water pool will be behind your oil zone. So some amount of oil, if you start injecting water from injection wells, then this water will pressurize oil to move towards your production well. In that way, some amount of water will start to encroach into the oil zone. It may bypass your oil water contact and it will start entering into the oil zone. That can be considered as WE. When it comes to WP, water produced, this water is not equivalent to WE. Why? Because this water production, produced water is that water which was already present inside the reservoir. So when you start producing oil, some amount of water is also being produced. So that water is considered to be WP. But WE is the water which started to encroach once you start injecting water from nearby injection well. Then next comes BW. BW represents formation volume factor of water. So when you are cross multiplying formation volume factor of water with WP, it will give you the amount of water which have been produced from the reservoir. When there is no BW, it will be giving you the amount of water which was present. It will not be calculated with respect to reservoir. But when you cross multiply WP with any, like any parameter, either oil or gas or water, if you cross multiply with formation volume factor, that will be giving you the amount which was present inside the reservoir, minus gas injection. So GING, that represents amount of gas which have been injected nearby a well. Then comes BGING. So injected gas which was present inside the well, when you cross multiply with formation volume factor of gas, that will give you the amount of gas which have been injected that is present inside the reservoir. So this is the amount of gas which have been injected that is present inside reservoir, that will be giving you this term, GING into BGING. If BGING is not available, if you are not, you are just putting the value of GING, that means it will be giving you the amount of gas which you have injected. But when you cross multiply with BGING, it will be giving you the amount of gas which you have injected that is present inside the reservoir. That is what GING into BGING. The same formula and application will be applied for WING and BW also. WING is water which was injected, which is not equivalent to WP, either W. W is the water which was present beyond the reservoir, which started to encroach. WP is the water which was present inside the reservoir that started to produce at the surface, that is WP. WING is the water which you have injected from water injection well. When you cross multiply WING with BW, that will be giving you the amount of water which was present inside your reservoir, which was injected from your water injection well. In the same way, when it comes to BO, that is formation volume factor of oil. When it comes to BOI, the same formation volume factor of oil at initial conditions. So the value will be different. When you calculate formation volume factor of oil after some product, some time production, that is BO. When you started to calculate the same value at initial conditions, that values will be different. Why? Because at initial conditions, solution gas will be compressed inside oil. In that way, the formation volume factor of oil at initial condition could be lower when it is compared to BO at production conditions. That is, there won't be any suffix. You can just name it as BO, that represents it is at production conditions. In the same way, RSI minus RS. RS represents solution gas, the amount of gas which have been dissolved in unit amount of oil, that can be named it as RS. So when you are suffixing with I, that represents initial amount of gas, like at initial conditions, what is the amount of gas which have been dissolved in unit amount of oil? So when that is RSA, but when you come to RS, this RS is at any time of production, you can able to extract. RS value will always change. RSA will never change. Why? Because RSA will always be constant. At initial conditions, the amount of gas which have been dissolved in oil will be constant. But during time progresses, during pressure reduction, so there could be number of changes happening inside the gas. So the solubility also will alter. So the solubility will vary when you progress into pressure reduction phase. So in that way, RS will always change. The amount of gas which have been dissolved inside oil at different pressures will be different, but RSA will always be constant. So when it comes to BG, formation volume factor of gas, so that we have discussed earlier. So M is a factor, like if you could observe, M is a factor that will be giving you a ratio between initial gas amount to initial oil amount. So M is a factor which will give you the ratio between initial oil amount to initial gas, sorry, initial gas amount to initial oil amount. So BOI, we discussed earlier, that is initial formation volume factor, BG, formation volume factor at production conditions, BGI at initial conditions, and BOI 1 plus M, I have discussed earlier. So SWI, that is like initial water saturation, that can be named it as Kunnet water saturation also. So CW represents compressibility of water, and CF represents compressibility of formation. So compressibility of water means like water will be compressed with overburden pressure. Once the pressure is released, this compressed water, which acts as a drive mechanism to push oil which was present in front of it towards your pore spaces. So that could be very infinitesimal, but still it acts as a drive mechanism. In the same way, CF is compressibility of formation. So with overburden pressure, rocks also will get compressed. Once you start producing crude oil from the reservoir, this rocks pressure also will be relieved in such a way that these compressed rocks will start to get expanded in such a way it will imbibe, or it will just push oil which was present inside that pore spaces towards the reservoir side. So that also acts as a drive mechanism. That is rock compressibility as well as saturation of Kunnet water saturation, that also acts as a compressed fluid, which will act as a drive mechanism. So delta P represents the pressure difference. Why? Because when there is pressure difference, there is a chance of compressibility. So either it will be compressed or it will be relaxed. It depends on pressure difference. So when there is a pressure difference, fluid also will start to get expanded. It acts as a drive mechanism. In the same way, formation rock also will act as a drive mechanism. So let us come to production decline curves. So this is one among very important reserve estimation techniques. So how this will help us to estimate reserves for coming days, so that will be discussed. Let us think that we are having a data of flow rate and time. So we are having some amount of flow rate data is there and the time data is there. If you plot it on an XY axis, that let us take Y on Q, that Y is on flow rate and X axis towards time. And let us think that we have a production time. So that is TP. So up to TP, there is production time is available. So we started to produce, we have already generated data. So we can able to produce data until production, how much until TP, whatever data is there, it started to produce, and we plotted that on XY axis. By this line, we can able to estimate slope. Based on the slope of this particular line, we can able to generate another equation. So that equation will be helping us to predict future of this particular production. So what is that equation? That is exponential equation. So it depends on the slope, what is available on this particular data. So if you have X data as well as Y data, we can able to generate slope. How this slope is connected to this equation, that has a different process. But if you have slope, you can able to generate another equation by using the term QT is equal to QI by 1 plus B DIT into whole power 1 by B. So QT is the flow rate at a particular time. T is like the time of your desire. Whatever time you want to estimate, that is given at T. QI is the flow rate at initial conditions. B is a constant for each production decline curve technique. DI is initial decline rate. T represents time. And DI is dependent on the slope of already raw data, what is available. That is like Q versus T. If you have any data earlier, so based on that data, you can generate slope. Then that slope can be connected to this DI so that we can able to generate estimated graph with that. That is your exponential. In the same way, it depends on the value. Each decline curve will be having a different B exponent values. So if you change the values of B exponent to be one, then there will be another graph that can be generated as hyperbolic. So that will be having a B value as one. When it comes to exponential, the value of B is considered to be zero. In the same way, when it comes to another production decline curve, then we can name that B value, which lies in between zero and one. Probably it could be like 0.2, 0.3, even 0.25. So the value could alter in between zero and one. That value, if you could take that value, then we can able to estimate your raw data with harmonic decline curve. So these three curves will always help us to estimate our raw data towards future. So how at present I have just generated three different curves with the raw data what is available. But if you could observe hyperbolic curve, like if you could observe this green color hyperbolic curve is matching with the slope of your raw data. So probably this could be the best fit for the data what you are having it. So you can able to estimate your future production, I mean flow rate, by applying hyperbolic than exponential and harmonic. Every graph will be providing you some estimations, but you have to observe which one will be the best fit for your raw data. So your raw data have already given you a trend line. So that has to be fitted with the trend line, which was there in this production data, like either exponential or hyperbolic or harmonic. You have to observe the slope, the trend, which is matching with which type of curve. In our case, in this case, probably hyperbolic is the curve which is providing you the best fit for the raw data. If you start regressing this particular production decline curves, these three curves for further future, so you can able to see how this will be estimated further. So until TP is the raw data which was estimated, then after that, whatever the regression happened beyond that, that is all the predicted data. And you have to see which one is matching with our raw data. Probably we can avoid in this case exponential and harmonic. Why? Because the slope which is matching with the hyperbolic can be considered and it can be taken further into the production side. Okay. This is the graph in between Q versus T. The same graph can be estimated with log Q versus T also. All the time we cannot able to get best fit from Q versus T. So sometimes we need to use natural logarithms to get the fit for this. So all the time this raw data cannot be considered for this particular trend. Probably this the trend of this raw data could maybe match with the log Q versus T trend also. So it depends on the match, like which one is matching with which type of curve. If that is the type, then you can able to go for the future estimation with that scenario. So in the same way, we can able to estimate different flow rates with different curves with Q versus cumulative Q, as well as log Q versus cumulative Q also. So it all depends on the data what is available. So based on that data, you can able to progress for future production. Okay, if you could observe it individually, this is exponential with the value of B, which represents zero. And the same way, if you start observing with hyperbolic, this is the value which was observed to be one. And when you observe with harmonic, this is how it will be, trend of harmonic curves will be. So let us come to the reservoir simulation part. So what exactly is reservoir simulation? So this simulation is always like confused with another term called stimulation. So stimulation is the topic which will be done during workover operations when there is a problem of producing crude oil from subsurface. If there is a constriction, then you need to apply some kind of acid fracturing or hot water injection in such a way that some channels will be loose enough so that oil will start to come smoothly into your reservoir. So that is stimulation. But when it comes to simulation, it is a kind of approximation. There could be always a data which was incomplete. Probably it is not like that all the time you have to start drilling a well for a particular area in extract crude oil, or as like a core sample and collecting that core sample, going to lab and getting the data from laboratory and finally estimating the properties based on that laboratory could not be the case for all the time. So what we have to do is, if you have some data, you can able to approximate with that data further into another location. So that is what exactly we named it as reservoir simulation. Reservoir simulation is very important reservoir estimation technique at present. Why? Because all the time, this will be time consuming. At the same time, there is no need for you to invest much amount so that you can start drilling, collecting core sample, doing all the experiments to generate good amount of information. So that is like very much expensive, that can be avoided by this discipline that is reservoir simulation. So in reservoir simulation, what we are going to do exactly, like there are a number of mathematical techniques out there which will be applied in reservoir simulation, as well as softwares which have been encrypting all these mathematical formulas, and based on that we can able to simulate. And this is an approximate result. It cannot be a real result, real time result, or else like we cannot 100% rely on that. But only the thing is, we can able to do approximation. We can predict future. We can able to get an idea that something, some kind of physical quantitative and output you can able to estimate at present. So for that reason, reservoir simulation will be useful. So what is, how you are going to start simulation? So I will be explaining you the initial stage of reservoir simulation. So it will always starts with discretization of your reservoir. What is discretization? Discretization is subdividing your reservoir with respect to time and space. So you are going, first of all, you need to, reservoir could be of different shapes. It could be, shape of reservoir cannot be identified, but this reservoir shape can be fitted into a known shape. Probably it is a rectangle or else as a cylinder. So reservoir can be fitted either into any kind of shapes. If it is fitted into that particular shape, then you have number of mathematical techniques are there to estimate the area, surface area, or else any kind of parameter you can have. Why? Because you know that shape, how to estimate all the areas. But reservoir shape is a rock which cannot be having a proper shape. That has to be fitted into one particular shape which was known earlier. So that is one thing. So, or else you need to subdivide reservoir into known shapes. So that is, that we will be seeing little later. Then when it comes to time, each time there will be changes that is going to observe inside the reservoir. So what are those changes and how it is going to be observed, and how reservoir simulation will help you to understand what are the changes happening inside the reservoir. So let us consider a reservoir. So this is a picture of reservoir, and this reservoir, when we are going to discretize this reservoir with respect to space as well as time. So first of all, I'm going to discretize this reservoir with respect to space. So this is one rectangle which have been drawn, and I have subdivided this rectangle with different grid blocks. So each grid block is unique. One grid block doesn't have the same property for other grid block. So I have subdivided reservoir into different grid blocks. So this is a rectangular reservoir, and which have been subdivided into five grid blocks. So, okay, this was estimated at time one. So this is the time I have given, like right now we are measuring values of this particular reservoir at time one. Okay, let us go for time two. when you go for time two, some amount, imagine that the black shady area which was observed at the left side of your reservoir is the saturation of oil which started to enter into the reservoir. When you simulate that reservoir with respect to space and time, it can be observed like this. It can be observed like this diagram. Like you can see, like five types of grid blocks are there, and one grid block was colored with a different color. So you have already decided that the color of orange will be simulated as the saturation of oil. So it happened at a time two. When it is at a time one, there is no presence of that color. That means there is no chance of oil which was present inside the reservoir. Once oil started to enter, imagine that if it is entering from the right hand side, probably the color will be on the right extreme of this particular grid blocks. Okay, I am doing this calculation at a time two level. Let us progress further to time three. So this saturation of oil started to progress further into the reservoir. So you can able to observe that this color started to observe. When you start simulating your reservoir, you can able to observe different color, like the same color which have been spreading to different grid blocks. Yes, there is always like whether the size of grid block matters a lot. But here what we are seeing is saturation of oil is calculated with the color of the grid block. So imagine if you started to give different color for different saturation, like gas, if you give a green color, probably the grid block will be filled with green color. So in that way, it all depends on how the reservoir description have been analyzed, as well as how you have encrypted that color for particular saturation. Then based on that, these grid blocks will be filled up. And actually to say, if you context this particular topic, it is like a pixel for a photograph. If imagine the pixel is high, like number of pixels are more, then the sharpness of photograph will be better. In the same way, if the pixel size is less, then probably it will be blurred. So you cannot able to see much variations. The sharpness of image will be reduced. In the same way, pixel can be contexted with the grid block of our reservoir. So let us consider a reservoir as a rock hole. We have collected some data like water saturation. There was presence of this water saturation at different locations. And if you start differently before simulating this further, first thing what we have to do is we need to grid these reservoirs. So first of all, we need to make grid blocks for each reservoir. Then you have to start simulating further. If you have gridded these blocks, then you have to observe that each grid block will be having complete color. See that every square part is filled with color. Like you can see, this color was why, because earlier we have these two values which were comprising to two grid blocks. So these two grid blocks have been observed in one color. So if you see a simulation graph, you will be simulation image, you will be observing colors like this. So all the points will be colored. Imagine in a grid block, if you are having more number of points, probably that color could be darker. But when there are having less values, it could be even lighter. So in the same way, for different colors for different fluid phases. Like imagine for water, if you could give blue, then you can go for oil to be given as green. So in that way, it depends on what software they are going to use and how the color is encrypted with the different fluids. Okay, if you want to, see, this is what representation, but if you want to simulate it, simulate means like you need to estimate the value of earlier block by having the already whatever data you are having, you're going to use that data to estimate further. So imagine that I want to find a value nearby the estimated value. This value which was here was already known. I have the data, I have the values for this, but I want to estimate the value which was beside that. So what are the techniques are there? There could be number of techniques, how you can use it with the distance formula, what you can use any kind of technique, but a simple technique I will be explaining. If your reservoir is homogeneous, if it is not having much variations, then this can be estimated like this. See, we have four different techniques are there to estimate a nearby value by application of this known values. Already a green block one is a known value. So right now you are going to estimate the unknown value, that is the question mark, by applying these four techniques. What are these four techniques? One is upstream weightage, one is downstream weightage, mixed weightage, and extrapolation weightage. So what is upstream? I already told you, if it is a homogeneous reservoir, if your grid block first value was defined, then other three values also will be defined with the same value. Why? Because it is homogeneous, so saturation can be extended to further. In the same way, if you know the last value, that can be weighted towards the earlier value, with the same value. Sometimes mixed weightage will be there. So you know the first one and second one value, the average of these two values will be subdivided to other two grid blocks. If imagine sometimes a value for one grid block was near to the value of another grid block, like this value was known, at the same time the extreme last value was also known. So it is not like you have to upstream this value and this value with SO1. You can give one value with SO1 which is near to the value which was already known, and you can give the value as SO2 to a value which was already known to the nearby SO2 value. So if it was known, the nearby value will be given higher priority. So you cannot give the value of this grid block as SO2. At the same time, you cannot give the value of this grid block as SO1. Why? Because SO2 means it is far away from SO2, which was already known. But there is another grid block is there, which was already known, that is nearby this grid block, that is SO1. So in that way, you can able to give the nearby values which was present near to the grid block. So that is what extrapolation weightage is all about. If you start observing these grid blocks in a larger scale, you can observe like number of grid blocks have been present in this particular simulated image. But the colors which were represented over here was always in a grid block, there won't be any two colors. There will be always one color. So one color represents one kind of property. So if you think that there is a chance of producing number of colors in one grid block, then you need to subdivide that grid block into number of other grid blocks. But if at the same time, you can see the variations could be observed a little less. Why? Because if the size of grid block is bigger, then the variations could not be that good. As I said earlier, if the pixel size is like, imagine the pixel number is very low, then you cannot able to get a sharper image. If the pixel number is high, then you can able to observe a sharper image. Number of variations can be observed. In the same way here, if grid block sizes were big, then the observation of variations could be little less. So you can see there, all the grid blocks are possessing different colors, but in one particular grid block, you are not observing two different colors. So each grid block is having a different color, but it is unique. You cannot able to observe two different colors. Imagine that you have an estimate that in that location, probably there could be different variations, then you need to downscale that particular grid block. So if there is a grid block like this, you have to subdivide this grid block into four different sections. In that way, you can able to estimate different variations. Sizing always matters. So if you could observe in this picture, there at time one, there is no presence of different fluids, but when it comes to time two, you can see different colors have been observed in this image, but we cannot able to see the variations sharply. So if you could observe here, the pixel size, I mean the grid block size is very much low, so that you can able to see the variations of how the that fluid is flowing, how the fluid started to curve over here, how it is progressing further, how it is retrieving back. Everything can be observed clearly if the size of grid block is less. So it all depends on how you are planning to observe this. Sometimes variations in one particular area like porosity could be very low. For that, there is no need to reduce the size of grid block. But when it comes to permeability, definitely in a heterogeneous reservoir, so much variations will be observed at different locations, so that you have to reduce the size of your grid block, and it can be observed precisely. So after this, let us come to conclusions. Simulation in reservoir estimations are one among the most significant methods followed by oil and gas industry. Why? Because it will reduce time as well as investment costs, so that it will be helping industry to estimate number of parameters further without much investment as well as consuming time. It acts as a protocol for production operations. So before getting into production operations, it will be giving you an idea. It will be giving, it will generate you what could, what is your target for your project? Like if you start production, what could be, what could be the goal of your project? So that can be estimated by reserve simulation and reserve estimation techniques. All four techniques have pros as well as cons. As I said earlier, volumetric can be applied for only homogeneous. When it comes to material balance, you can able to include number of trial mechanisms, but if you lose some data in material balance equation, that will become more complex. You cannot able to retrieve everything back. Then next comes production decline curves. Probably here, we are just estimating future with respect to the trend of a graph, but we are not considering any kind of properties like porosity, permeability, capillary pressure, saturation. So we are not considering any important, we are not giving any importance to this particular parameter. So without giving priority to this, we are estimating future. So probably that could happen, may not happen. That is up to the real-time data when it is getting progressed further. And the same time, when it comes to simulation, softwares are there, still has to get developed in such a way. So it is like a lot of things are there inside reservoir simulations, softwares being developed. So right now, a lot of research is going on to go further and further deeper into this particular area to get much amount of data. Long and short term reservoir prognostications can be done by reservoir estimation techniques. Why? Because short term goals as well as long term goals, how much time it is like, if you see production decline curves, it will give you the estimation of the life of a reservoir. So how much time it can be progressed, where it is going to end, and what could be the time where the economic level will be ending. So after that, production might not be suitable. So up to where the production line will be observed. So all these things can be understood by this reserve estimation time. You can able to prognosticate. Recent developments were concentrated on reservoir simulation. Definitely at present, reservoir simulation is one among the demandful field where softwares are being developed. At the same time, a lot of research is going on. Earlier, we don't have a choice. We have to go to the field, start drilling, collecting the core sample, getting the data through laboratory, and we have to get a report through that only. But at present, it is not the case. If you have already, if you have some data or else nearby wells, if they are having data, then they can able to simulate further. In that way, you are going to reduce time. At the same time, you can reduce investment costs. Lot of scope for advancing in this field. So definitely there are so much, even though you have cons, but you have a lot of scope is there for further progressing of this particular field. And it will help oil and gas industry if you could able to develop a new software in reservoir simulation. And that can be a useful tool for the oil and gas industry. So with that, I'm going to end my presentation. Thank you for Petroleum Engineers Association for giving me this opportunity. Thank you very much.